We've given the talk a deliberately wide title, Development, Disruptors and New Entities, and we've got two speakers who I think will talk to this subject extremely well. I met Moray Mclaren through the International Bar Association. Moray was the inaugural chair of the strategy group of the IBA's Law Firm Management Committee, and he's been advising leading law firms on strategy for more than 20 years. He's also a business school professor at IE University, an executive coach. He delivers leadership programs and has spoken at Harvard on their Institute of Coaching. So he comes with a huge and diverse experience, as well as obviously his own legal training. Richard Macklin comes to us from Dentons. I looked around for information about Richard and I couldn't find his years of service on the internet. I don't know if that's because he's trying to keep it under wraps and maintain his youthful demeanour, or whether it's for any other reason. But he's been in practice for 33 years at the highest level. He's a corporate lawyer by training, and I'm sure he'll talk more about his experience in that vein. But he's risen in later years to preeminence as one of Denton's global vice chairs. And his specialism is around strategy, obviously, and particularly emerging markets, which I think is a very interesting kind of springboard for tonight's talk, to talk about, you know, what a global law firm means and how global law firms operate in a constantly changing and disrupted marketplace. I'll leave both speakers to introduce themselves more fully as the evening wears on, but that's a taster to start. They're going to be speaking for around about 50 minutes or so, and they've said that during the speech they'd be very happy to take questions. So I think all the way through, if you've got thoughts, ideas, questions you want to feed in, do feel free to put your hand up and they'll come and find you. And equally, there'll be some time at the end for Q&A too. So thank you again to our speakers for coming along tonight. Let's start with a round of applause.
Thank you very much. Just to ask if you can hear me okay. Can you hear me okay at the back? So, as Chris knows, I live in Madrid. My office is in London. Every day of the week I'm in a different country, and everywhere I go, because I know I'm from London, they ask me the same question, okay? So can I ask whether I have a favour to ask you to start with? I don't know whether we're going to ban the Brexit word for the whole of this session, because I never know what to ask people, how to answer the question of how will legal services be affected by Brexit. And I think we have two choices, Richard. Either we decide we're not going to talk about it, or we decide if we're going to talk about it, we have to say something new and a bit serious. Because I don't know how you feel. I think I'm getting a bit tired of talking about the same thing the whole time. So, you know, as part of a spoiler warning, I do have a Brexit slide. And when I get the Brexit slide, you get to tell me whether you want to talk about what that means for law firms or whether we just skip to the next slide, okay? What we're going to do, I'm going to talk for about 20 minutes about what I'm seeing with law firms globally. And then Richard's going to talk more specifically about his firm. We're very grateful for you to come. We know it's the end of the day. And we thought we'd ask by seeing who was still awake in the audience and who was... Come and join us. Come and have a seat. Come and join us. Your timing is perfect. So I'm going to ask to show you three slides. And I'm going to see if anyone here in the audience recognises who they are and what the link is between these three individuals. Okay? Are we ready? Slide number one. Who is this gentleman? David Morley. Okay, tell us who David Morley is. Oh, it's true, very true. He's lost weight since then, hasn't he? Okay. Why do you think we're talking about David Morley when we're talking about changes within law firms? What's the connection there? So, David Morley, as we just quite rightly heard, was a senior partner of one of the most successful law firms in the world, with a turnover over $1 billion. And one of my favourite quotes from David is when he said, "We have to reinvent ourselves or disappear." So the first question we've got to answer within the next hour is why and how do law firms have to reinvent themselves? Okay. Second person. Does anyone recognise this lady?
Queen of Spades.
Queen of Spades are very, very close. It's the Queen of Hearts, isn't
it?
So this will be easy for those of you in the audience who have children. So this is the Red Queen. This is what we know in the strategy world as the Red Queen dilemma. Alice goes through the looking glass. She's on the other side. She's standing next to the Red Queen, and she's running. And she's running as fast as she can. And she's looking at the Red Queen, and she's thinking, why, if I'm running, am I not going anywhere? So this is the answer from the Red Queen. Now here you see, it takes all the running you can do just to keep in the same place. If you want to get somewhere else, you must run at least twice as fast. So the second part of the presentation is about the change in legal services and the way that 10 or 20 years ago, we would have looked at some of the highly successful but rather sleepy law firms in the world. And when we talk about a more dynamic business sector, there's been a huge amount of change. So this is what we call the Red Queen dilemma within legal services. So last but not least, you've done very well so far. It's this gentleman here.
Charles Darwin.
It makes me wonder if he's actually been here. I don't know how old this room is, but I'm sure it was around when he was young. So Charles Darwin, the quote from Charles Darwin that we always hear is about the survival of the fittest. But I don't know where that's totally correct. The quote that I'm going to use from him today is, it's not the strongest species that survive, nor the most intelligent, but the ones most responsive to change. So we're going to talk about change in legal services. And it made me laugh, made me smile, that Chris, when he put on the invitation today to you all to come, he mentioned the famous book by Richard Susskind, The End of Lawyers. But he did Richard Susskind a disservice, because of course the book title is The End of Lawyers? And it made me laugh because a few years ago Richard was speaking at the inaugural conference of a law firm network, one of the most successful important networks in the world. And his keynote speech was going to be at 5:30 in the afternoon, and afterwards there was going to be this fantastic champagne reception for 1,000 important people from legal services. Now, I was one of the speakers, but I was speaking much earlier in the day, and one of the organisers had a bit of a last-minute thought and a bit of a last-minute fear. The question was, if we're going to have Richard Susskind talk about the end of lawyers, what will that mean for our champagne reception afterwards? So they asked me instead to interview Richard so we could try and end the day with a happy note. And I must say that I'm a great optimist. And I would like to say, as my sort of supposition today, we have seen a lot of change within legal services, but I think that the law firms, the traditional law firm model has been much more resilient than we would have thought. Now, as part of my day-to-day work, I do advise top law firms around the world, and many of them tell me in their moments of worry that they feel a little bit like this frog in the water that's getting warm. But another one of my suggestions to you this evening is going to be that when we talk about legal services, we are always very, very guilty of overestimating the change in the short term over the next two or three years. But at the same time, we're very, very guilty of overestimating those long-term trends. So I'm going to be presenting to you what I think are the long-term trends, and then that'll give us an idea of where we think law firms are going to end up. Of course, this is our starting point for any presentation, the change in relationship between the lawyer and the client, but Richard's going to help us unpack that in a minute. I really want to focus on the question of, when in-house lawyers look externally for legal services, what are they looking to buy? What we'd call the build or buy decision, and the result of what they want to buy, what does that mean in terms of law firm models? So as well as law firms, I also advise in-house legal departments, and this is the model that I've been working with them over the last few years to try and work out what they should be spending their time doing. If you look at the screen, we've got on the y-axis, is this legal work politically important to the business? And on the x-axis we've got, is it legally difficult or not? So let me start with the two quadrants that the clients have typically done themselves, and that's the top left quadrant, which is work that is politically important for the business, it's mission critical, but it's not legally difficult. And that's the day-to-day work the general counsel describe as putting out fires, plumbing, making the system work. That's the bit they enjoy a lot, and that's the bit they want to do themselves. So that's the bit that they keep, and they don't externalise that. Equally, if you look at the opposite segment on the bottom right, you've got the legal work that's legally difficult, but hasn't been politically important to the business. And we don't have time to go into this into detail now, because I've only got 20 minutes, but this is the segment that I see the biggest amount of change within legal services. This is the quadrant that we would have talked about being regulatory 5 or 10 years ago, but we can now use words that are much more dramatic, like risk or compliance. And this is a quadrant that a general counsel explained to me recently is what they feel is the ticking bomb under their organisations. Now, this is an area that in the old days, a client would come to a law firm, recruit one of the younger lawyers, 5 or 6 years qualified, and they would have internalised that regulatory work. Now, part of that work has become at the ranch, and as we see in a minute, it'll move up to the top right, but a large part of that day-to-day compliance type work has been hugely standardised and has moved over to the bottom left. So the bit that I really want to focus on, the bit I want to help us understand the law firm model is the top right and the top left. The bottom left is the work, it hasn't been seen as mission critical to the business, and it also hasn't been seen as legally difficult. And of course that's the day-to-day standard work of the in-house lawyer, and that's a large part of what they've been externalising. And as we're going to say in a minute, that will be an even larger part going forward. And the top right, I've called that rocket science. And in different parts of the world, they call this different things. The Americans call it bet the ranch, and I guess in London, we could probably call it bet the bank work.
We call it bet the ranch too.
Bet the ranch. Richard calls it bet the ranch too, but they're sort of a very American type firm sometimes. This is what my colleague Peter Cornell calls the filet mignon. And in many countries, they try and work out what is a filet mignon. But that what he will say is that we have to recognise that the filet mignon has many layers to it. But if you want to know what is that rocket science work, it could be as straightforward as saying, what is the work the lawyers can still bill an hourly fee for? And what is it that the areas of work that the client will pay top dollar for? So those are our sort of two areas. I mean, this is the way general counsel would view this. And what I've seen over the last 5 and 10 years is general counsel have become much better at understanding what we would call the value curve. In the old days, they'd often go to a handful of firms and give them a large part of this work. And now they're much more precise in who is the right type of firm or the right speciality to give me different areas of work across that. And now we're seeing the law firms having to catch up. I interviewed a global client of one of the London Magic Circle firms, and I said, what do you think of the pricing for the legal services? And the answer was really, really fascinating. He said, for the low value work, they're very expensive, and for the expensive work, they're very cheap. So you tell me, if you're the managing partner of a law firm, which is worse? The cheap work they were too expensive for? I guess it's not stretching imagination to think that that's work they're not going to get going forward. But for that very expensive work, that filet mignon, they could have charged a bit more. Now, this is the way that the clients view that work, but from a law firm perspective, we might look, isn't there anything in between those two areas of work? So 5 or 10 years ago, we would have thought, what about the work that's not rocket science? It's not as important as that, and it's not quite as standard as the cheap work that they buy in price. This is the relationship work. This is the day-to-day work of the lawyer. The lawyer providing the client with the day-to-day advice on the birth, life, and hopefully not death of a business. When the client's looking for that trusted advisor and help for looking around corners and seeing what's coming next. Now, when I taught a class with Ben Hyman a few years ago, Ben Hyman was the global general counsel at GE. He said, the problem is that in the way we're now viewing legal services, we're at great risk of forgetting about that relationship type work in the middle, where clients have relied upon that trusted advisor in the external law firms. And I would like Richard to talk about that a bit later and where that relationship work has gone. The other thing that is from the chart, I have an escalator here. This is my poor attempt at drawing an escalator. And the bad news is it's not an escalator that goes up, it's an escalator that goes down. And this is the escalator that we're used in order to explain the standardization of legal services, or what we could call the commoditization. Because it would be no surprise to you that the work that today is rocket science and done by the leading experts in London or around the world, tomorrow goes to a more junior partner. The more it's done over time, it goes to senior associates. The work from senior associates goes to associates. The work from associates goes to paralegals. The work from paralegals is done by administrative staff or secretaries. So the bad news about legal services, as you will know, and you can all imagine the different types of legal services in your own work in different types of jurisdictions, that is going from our top right, the ranch work, down to the relationship work and down to the standardised work. And the bad news, of course, for law firms is we've seen that process becoming much more quicker. And as we're going to see, if you do want to stay at the top right and you do want to do that bet the ranch work, that's going to be much more complicated going forward. And last but not least, before we go to the next slide and before we turn off this model, we have traditionally seen different buckets of work around these main areas. And now we have to add one more level of complication to this, because we shouldn't view different types of legal services as being either expertise or not. From a client perspective, even the most expertise work has elements that are relationship or elements that are standardized. So our model for how we view the general counsel role and the work they externalize has become much more complicated. And we've now got the word disaggregation. If every bit of legal advice or every transaction has different elements of higher value or lower value work, or what I should call high cost or low cost work, who is going to do that disaggregation going forward? Is the client going to understand that process and recruit project managers to do that? Or is it that we're going to look to law firms to do that disaggregation, and as a result, to do more of those types of work? Okay, so we'll come back to the moment. And looking at the model and looking at the way legal markets are changing, one thing we do in Eckington as part of our strategy work is we look at different legal markets. We're very keen to find out from clients who do they think are able and the best able to provide those different types of legal services along our value curve. And what we've seen is that there's been a huge crystallization within law firms, because the client is seeing some as higher value or lower value, and there's also that polarization. Now, I don't know if I'm talking to a room full of optimists or pessimists, but what I'm going to argue is there is going to continue to be a role for law firms providing that filling in your work, but there'll be even fewer law firms that are able to provide that and will have the brand. So it's that concept of winner takes all. For the law firms that are in that space that do this strategy and disaggregation bit well, there is a very, very healthy future. The question for the law firms is, do they have an appetite to do some of that standard work? And it's work that's not going to be provided by lawyers, it's going to be provided by engineers, technologists, people using software. Do they have the systems, the culture and approach to do that standard work and to do it profitably? Or is the firm going to make a go for that bet the ranch work? Do they feel they have the brand and the brains and the people to be able to do that work as well? So, those are our three buckets of work, and of course, you know, we're talking very naively about buckets, but it does help us really understand this. Bill Henderson has done fantastic research on how has that type of work been changing, and that gives us a clue to how the law firm models will change in parallel. What he said is, when he goes back in time, he goes back to 1915, he's talking about what type of work were American corporations externalising to law firms. And back in 1915, this is his assumption from all of his research, that it was the rocket science work was the main part being externalised, and as a result, the main part being done by the top law firms. If we jump forward 100 years, we can already see the change in relationship. And if we bring it up to date, 2015, and if we jump forward to 2025. This is his prediction of how the external legal services will look. So if you could just imagine that switch from the large amount of rocket science work to the large amount of standard work, we have to really work out what impact that will make to external law firms. Is it an opportunity or a threat? Okay, goes back to the question about am I talking to a bunch of optimists or a bunch of pessimists? For those that are optimists, there is some good news. What is the good news on the chart here behind me? There is still going to be premium work. But if you look at the numbers, he's calculating globally $7 billion of premium work versus $268 billion of standard work. So what does that mean to law firms? And we started with a picture of David Morley. And David Morley and Wim de Jong were one of the first global firms to say, in response to this type of research, in response to the type of changing needs by clients, what are we going to do? And what they say, as you can see, is firms have to decide whether they stick with a diminishing market for pure premium work, or they accept that in order to win a greater share of the premium work, they must combine it with alternative delivery models. And they say in a very bold call, maybe more to the partners in their own firm than to the market externally, do they rise to the cost challenge or shrink to the diminishing top end? Shrinking is not for us. So, stage one for law firms is to think about what is their ambition and what type of work do they want to do, and as a result, what is the business model to provide that? Because we're now seeing much clearer information about what is the price sensitivity, what is the leverage model required, is it our rocket science work, which is with a very low leverage, or is it our standard work? So that's my attempt in 10 minutes to talk about the changes we're seeing in legal services. And now I'm going to be very bold because I'm going to look a bit to the future. And the challenge with legal services in the future, and the challenge for all of you that are law students here today, is that we're not really sure what the future holds. Because this is kind of our work in progress. But I'm going to take a bet and I'm going to make some guesses on what I think is going to happen. So, I've taken Coca-Cola as an example. I'm sure we all drink and see Coca-Cola. While legal services, we think we're very special and we think we're very unusual, it wouldn't be surprising if other types of products in other markets have been through these same challenges. So, three types of Coca-Cola, three types of law firms going forward, and the first one is the classic law firm model. So my children are huge fans of this gentleman. If for those of you that haven't met him yet or don't know, Harvey Specter from Pearson Specter Litt. They keep changing the names, and I'm not sure where the names have got to now. Do you remember what the names are?
The same.
The same, okay. Very successful firm. So I am betting, do we have some fans in the audience? I am betting, based on the research from Bill Henderson and our own research at Lexington, that there will still be a healthy future for the classic law firm. Clients, when they get that really difficult situation, that high-stakes litigation, that big takeover they want to stop, they will still be going to classic law firms and they still would be paying top dollar for that. The question really is, based on what everything we've heard, it's only going to get tougher at the top. And if you speak to people like Charles Martin speaking, I know some of you may know him, he's the senior partner at McFarlane's, one of London's most profitable law firms. Even if you're able to have the brand and the reputation to do that filly in your work, you're still going to have to cost effective. And the challenge then really is in a world where the standardization, that commoditization is getting more rapid, how or what do you have to do to stay in that top right sector? Well, it's definitely going to be about brand. Those with the most powerful brand succeed. It's still going to be about brains and recruiting the right people. But what does it take to stay at the cutting edge where the client comes in with a problem that you haven't solved before and you have to take a blank piece of paper and solve that. Is it about specialisation in sectors? It could be. Is it about working very, very closely with those clients? And there is a question here that if there are going to be lower value parts of the work that these people do at this law firm, how are they going to do that? And it's been no surprise to me when we talk about technology, and we'll get to technology a bit later, it's been some of the world's elite law firms that have been investing most in technology. And it's been some of the world's elite law firms who have been thinking most about working with alternative providers. Moray Mclaren, we were just talking about a moment ago, Portugal. One of Portugal's top law firms was the first to subscribe to Luminance, the artificial intelligence tool. And Slaughter May had a joint venture with Carillion Advisory Services. Now, Carillion Advisory Services, I don't want to call them a low-cost shop, because they are very, very skilled people at doing business process mapping around legal services and helping clients work out the best way to resource their different type of services. And in a very innovative move, it was Linklaters and Slaughter May that worked with Carillion on helping them sort out and helping them do some of that day-to-day work. But we'll come back to Carillion Advisory Services in a moment, because they're going to be part of our future story. So, there will still be that classic law firm, but they're going to have to think about how to stay in that space. The biggest challenge to classic law? What do we think? We talk about clients, and hopefully we can persuade Richard to talk a bit about clients later, but if I was to look at the biggest challenge to classic law, it wouldn't be clients, it would be this group of individuals. And I guess that's some of you sitting here in the audience. So if we look at our typical law firm recipe, this is the recipe we've been using for the partnership model for the last 200 years. It's a very, very simple, beautifully simple model. You almost shovel in your junior lawyers at the bottom, then through a process of maybe sort of sink or swim, some of them stay, some of them don't. You see I've put in some potential leverage here, and I've put in some potential salaries which you can change for each of your model. And the real key to the success of this traditional model was, it's what the Americans very, very nicely call the partnership tournament. As long as the junior lawyers feel they have a chance of making partner, which gets you the $1 million, you're willing to work 12 hours, 20 hours a day, 20 hours a day, 7 days a week for 10 or 15 years. Okay? So the Americans call this a partnership tournament. I like the English expression, which is a bit more blunt, which is up or out. Or as one managing partner in a law firm calls this, FIFO. Has anybody heard the expression F-I-F-O? Know what it means? Yeah, typically it's first in, first out. But in terms of law firms and the way he describes his law firm culture, he called this fit in or fuck off. You can tell us when we finished our presentation how this model works, because unless we can continue to persuade young people to put in the effort to become partner, our whole concept of the partnership model becomes very, very difficult. We're already seeing some tensions, which I'm showing very simply here, and even in classic law, we're seeing the bottlenecks. The bottlenecks because some of these firms are deleveraging to maintain their profitability. There's less basis for partners at the top, so what do? You can't be an equity partner, you can become a salaried partner. You can't become a salaried partner, so we'll call you of counsel. Some of the work is the day-to-day work, so we don't have lawyers doing it, we have paralegals. So already our pyramid is fairly and squarely gone, and we're now talking about our diamond, the law firm diamond. So even within classic law, firms are trying to structure themselves in thinking about the client demand and thinking about the aims and aspirations of a new generation of young people. Okay, so much for classic law, and hope that hasn't made anyone in the audience feel too uncomfortable. Here we have our Coca-Cola Light. Do we have any Coca-Cola Light drinkers in the audience? Yeah? So this is what we're calling the hybrid model. And this is my story around the hybrid model. And it was actually Richard Macklin who told me this story first. And I'm going to give you a dollar. It's a true story. Right. I'll tell it to my way. You can tell me if I've said it properly or not. So do any of you recognise this telephone? Yeah?
Nokia
telephone. Do any of you still have that phone or still have a Nokia phone? So Nokia has this fantastic phone. We all had it, and the Nokia salesmen are travelling around trying to sell it, and they weren't doing very well, and the feedback to Nokia head office was, we're trying to sell this $200 phone, and the customers keep telling us they want to pay $100. Okay? What a difficulty. The company didn't do very well. It went bust. It got bought by Microsoft. The Financial Times go to interview the new CEO of the business, and they say to the new CEO of the business, now that Nokia's been reborn, what is your strategy going to be going forward? And he said, in, I'm sure, a much more eloquent and longer way, look, if the public want a $100 phone, our question is, how are we going to make a $100 phone? Hopefully that was almost right.
Can I tell you a little story?
Tell us from this. Yes, go on, let me tell us.
Actually, because it's about how it works in law firm. It illustrates the point perfectly.
Yeah.
But this is a true story. It was a $50 phone, which was in those days. I did do a lot of work for Nokia in the MA world, and I remember bidding for a piece of work for them, and they were horrified by my suggested fee. I'd done a lot of deals with them, so we got on well. They looked at me and said, Richard, trouble you lawyers is that you are the only people that do it this way around. He said, if we asked you to build a phone, what you do is you say, right, well, we need this much plastic and this much lithium and this much R&D, and then we need a bit of delivery and marketing. And each phone will therefore cost you $972,467.42.
Yeah.
It doesn't work that way. And what they said is, the way everybody else in the world, except professional service firms, and particularly lawyers, do it, is they say, right, we need to build a brick phone that we want to sell into a market opportunity called Africa, and it's got to be at $50 because Samsung is banging it out for $52. All it needs to do is make phone calls, not toast, tell the weather for the farmer so he knows what his crops are going to be, whether his crops are going to make it or not next day, and not melt in the sun. $50, not $52, go figure. And so what do? What they do is they take the price point and they work backwards. So of course they don't build it in the US, they don't build it in the UK, they build it somewhere sensible. They also source all the materials from somewhere sensible, such that they can actually produce the phone at the right price point and then sell it and make a margin. And if they can't do it, they scrap the project. And that was this absolutely true story of how I started on the journey of innovation to understand how the market has to change. And now that's very much how we price things, and lots of other law firms too, and David does the same thing brilliantly with his service delivery.
Yeah.
So that happened.
I'll continue and then we'll come back to you. So this is this is what Richard is really telling us about, though. So this is the sort of disaggregated model of legal services. The question is, the client wants to make a $50 phone, where do you need people? Front office, middle office, and back office. What type of people do you need? Some of it will be the brains work, maybe the design part of it, and some will definitely be that sort of straightforward paralegal type work at the bottom. The terminology which I get lost in, outsourcing, insourcing, offshoring, nearsourcing. But there's been one group of global firms, and Richard is one of them, where this is the day-to-day work on how to do disaggregate and how to provide that service in a way the client is willing to pay for it. So this sort of crosses our span of the rocket science, the relationship and the commodity work. And it raised a number of questions. I mean, the first one is always about brand. If you are doing different parts of the disaggregation, do you use your main law firm name or do you use different people? Are these all going to be law firms or are they going to be different entities? And what about the career of your future lawyers? What about you here that are going to be seeking work within a law firm? So as part of that process, law firms are having to think their legal careers. And if you go to John Adelshaw Goddard's in London here, you will have a choice of different careers. Will it be the more standardised banking work? Will it be a legal executive qualification, which is more paralegal? or want to be that traditional partner in a law firm approach. And what I see when I talk to law firms about these options here, I have to do something very, very difficult, which is I have to try and guess the age of the people in the room. Because when I talk about this to people who are 50, 55, many of them think, I hope that I'm out the door before this happens, okay? And one of the reasons they're thinking they want to be out the door is because this requires investment and it requires a long-term view. And while a business will typically spend 8% of their turnover every year on investing in change, investing in the future, under our wonderful law firm model we saw a minute ago, at the end of every year, the partners look at the income, they take away the costs, anything left is seen as profit, and they just decide how to divide that and how to put their money in their pocket. And when I look at partners in a firm that are anything in their 30s or 40s, their question is, by God, we have to do this, and we have to invest in this, because if we don't, I'm not sure what I'm going to be doing in this law firm in 10, 15 or 20 years' time. The big challenge, of course, is around culture. We know from all our research that lawyers, not only are they perceived as being among the most intelligent of professions, so congratulations, at the same time they're seen as being among the most autonomous. And one of the biggest and most important motivations for any lawyer is to be able to control their day-to-day work. And what anything around this hybrid model requires is people working in teams, people collaborating across nations, across cultures around the world. It sounds very easy for a Nokia or a Microsoft to do that, but when it comes to law firms, that is exceedingly complicated. Many of the law firms that have looked to outsource lawyers, they've gone to Belfast, they've gone to Newcastle, they've put lawyers in Warsaw, they find that the lawyers in head office are not using those people, and it's not working as effectively as it could. So yes, we can talk about disaggregation, yes, we can talk about technology, but at the heart of it, we have to remember that there's people, and there's people that have to change behaviours, and that is much easier said than done. So, that's our hybrid model. Let's finish off with our alternatives. Has anybody drunk this or seen this? No? No? This is only available in certain parts of the world, in Asia. You have, yeah?
Got it, Sweden.
In Sweden? Yeah. Okay, I didn't know they got to Sweden. This is the green tea version. And this is our metaphor for the alternative law. And of course, this is one area that people have been writing about and researching a lot about. And I guess it used to be a secret, but maybe the secret is public. These are people that started off delivering low-cost legal services. They don't work as partnerships. They work as companies. They don't have any of the complications of trying to get 200 or 2,000 partners to agree on what they want to do. They don't have the complication of getting funding from partners to do this because they can go and get private equity investment. And they are now providing increasingly high-value legal services and competing increasingly with the global law firm. Last but not least, this is the one that we do tend to overlook when we talk about the changes in legal services. That's all of those clients that are very quietly working away by themselves to internally organize legal services in their different ways. And for those of you that are law students here, if you think about where you want to go and where you want to train, it might be that in 2 or 3 years' time, it's not a global law firm you go to, it might be one of the global businesses. Nokia in particular, it's funny, we must be having, not Nokia, sorry, Hewlett-Packard in particular, I was about to say we're having a Nokia evening. Hewlett-Packard in particular are now trying to attract the top young lawyers to do all of their training and all of their work within Nokia. So maybe if we're feeling cheeky, we'll ask Richard at the end of the presentation, if you had the choice, would you go and work in a law firm with all of the implications that has, or would he be interested in actually going to work in a business like Hewlett-Packard and having a different type of career working in a global organization, which might actually suit very well some of those aims and aspirations of the young lawyers. 2 points to finish. You will all know more about technology than I will ever understand. Will robots replace lawyers? Well, some of you are nodding your head. Here's my guess in 5 seconds about robots and law. If you are doing premium law and you do have the best brains in town, I think it would be exceedingly difficult for any type of technology to replace you. But let's remember that technology could actually enhance you and make you be a better lawyer. My mother was having treatment in London here at the Nuffield Hospital for cancer. And it's no surprise when it comes to treating different types of cancer, which have different implications. When it comes to calculating the medication, our brain just isn't able to do that type of mathematics and to understand the difficulty of those types of questions. So it isn't too difficult to imagine that going forward, our top lawyer will have their artificial intelligence tools, they'll be working with them and enhancing them and making them much better at what they do. It isn't a threat to those partners, it just helps them with the bits that the human brain, where the human brain has limitations. For that relationship work, I tend to think of this as sushi work, because sushi is seen as high premium in the market, but there's clever people in China, more than those clever people in Japan, and now of course have machines and systems and processes which can make sushi without anyone having to touch it. So within that relationship work, a lot of thought is going into technology. And Richard, we might get the technology a bit later. We might mention some of the technology that law firms are using. It's not replacing lawyers. It's just making the work they do more quick, and it's allowing the more junior lawyers to do that. So within that relationship work, which is under fee pressure, it is becoming exceedingly important. And when it comes to our standard work, do we think technology is important? So any lawyer who's currently sitting in London, who spends a lot of their time inputting anything into a computer, well, the good news is they won't be having to do that going forward. That's where things like artificial intelligence are going to be, I don't even want to say replacing lawyers. They're going to be doing that day-to-day task much better than any lawyers want to, and much, much more than any of you in the room would like to do in your future legal career. Now you know I'm a total optimist. I've given myself away, haven't I? To finish off, this is the Brexit slide, but no one is putting their hand up to ask any questions. I've lost the slide there. I work around the world, and if I was any of you thinking about Brexit and what Brexit will do to the London legal market, my honest opinion, speaking with lawyers about the work they do for London law firms, is that it may have no effect or a very minimum impact at all. The slide that isn't working on the screen was research we did on different markets and referrals. And when we go into different markets to do research, London is still the biggest market for legal referral around the world. New York comes second, continental Europe comes third. London has been able to develop itself as a centre of the world legal web. I've helped a lot of independent law firms come to London to open because they want to be at the centre of that web. And I haven't seen anything yet to convince me that Brexit or whatever happened with Brexit will in any way undermine the role of London going forward. But if you do want to talk about Brexit, let's come back to that at the end. Conclusion. Lawyers are having to ask very, very difficult questions about legal services going forward. I am a huge optimist, and I had fun with Richard Susskind being the good cop to the bad cop. We're not seeing the end of lawyers? Question mark. The future for classic law is looking bright. It's just that model won't be for everybody going forward. And a number of other law firms, and this is real work in progress, are trying to work out what do they do with that? The clients are buying legal services in different ways. They're unbundling, they're disaggregating legal services. And how will that work in the world going forward? And if you do have questions once we're finished, I'll be really interested in hearing your thoughts on how you think that's going to impact on your studies and on your future career. Because if this disaggregation bit is work in progress, who the hell knows what you're going to be doing in the law firm in 5, 10, or 15 years? And if you don't know what you're going to be doing in the law firm, how is a law faculty like this able to know what they're going to train you. Are they going to continue training you in specific areas of law, or are they going to train you in the mental arithmetic and gymnastics you're going to need to do as young lawyers? Is it going to be about problem solving and interpersonal skills going forward, more than actually learning areas of law that is under risk from technology? So that's my opening. We have some questions to put to Richard. What do you want to do? Do you want to stay there and I'll stand up, or do you want to come and stand up and keep me company? You look very comfortable.
I'm very comfortable, I see
you. Oh, I was hoping to get you up here with me. Okay then, Richard, I have just spent 20 minutes talking about what I see. Well, have I been longer than 20 minutes?
21.
21 minutes. Any advance on 21? Okay. So, is this a fair vision of the future, or is this just pie in the sky? What's your view from a major law firm?
Well, I think the first thing I'll say is, interesting what you said about that question that you might ask me at the end is, would I go into a business or would I go into a law firm? I mean, the important point to remember is that a law firm is a business. And whilst that bet the ranch stuff, rather that high-end work is talked about a lot and possibly the most profitable, it's not necessarily the sole focus of what we do, and it's not necessarily the holy grail either, because what we're interested in as a business is profit. And whilst when we're at university, it's going to be a lawyer, and in our early days of a legal firm, we want to do the most interesting, technically challenging work. We don't want to stop doing that necessarily. It's very important that we as businesses capture as much work as we can on a profitable basis. Mm-hmm. So that's the first thing I'll say is, it's not a choice between businesses and law firms. Law firms are first and foremost businesses focused very, very clearly on profit. Is it fair that that's what the future's going to look like? Yeah, I think so. I think clearly the types of jobs that will be available going forward will be fewer of the classic model. That's not at all a bad thing. You mentioned Kira and Luminance, those technologies, AI technologies, very good ones that we use as well in our model. And they come to us and they pitch their products to us. I always say to them, guys, you've got to pitch wrong, because they come to us and they say, we don't want to replace lawyers, we just want to help you. And we know what they're trying to say to us there. They don't want to fry us off, turkeys and Christmas and all that good stuff, but actually we say to them, you've got it completely wrong, guys. We want you to replace lawyers, because we don't want to have to continue to pay very, very high salaries to a lot of people who've studied at very good universities to do very, very dull work that clients actually are no longer quite rightly prepared to pay for. We love machines to do that. If we could have machines doing that, then we could actually employ fewer lawyers doing higher end work. And most importantly, of course, the clients will be happy to pay for it. And I think there's a myth often that is out there about law firms, and it's not just about Dentons or anybody else, all law firms are the same on this, I think. We really don't enjoy charging lots of money just because the work's there. We really only enjoy charging money when we're adding value, for the reason that A, we're not going to have an argument with the client over at the end, which is quite tricky, of course, but B, we want the client to be happy with what they're getting so that they will come back for more, and also that we feel that we're doing something useful and fulfilling. And therefore, a machine takes away the stuff that we're running at a loss, and that we can therefore focus on the high value stuff, or stuff that the client is happy to pay for at the right price.
Yeah.
And that works for us.
All right, can I ask?
Yes.
It's also possible to be an answer to this question. Is that, all of the, when you start as a lawyer, as a trainee, and you have work to practice on, cutting teeth, court, or appeal, if all of that work is going to be commoditized, how are you as a dentist going to train the next generation of high value living lawyers if you've got nothing to practice on?
Yeah, and a very century when I was doing that, sort of doing microfiches and looking at company searches and doing things which obviously now were automated a long time ago. I'm not sure I learned much from that actually, and a lot of the due diligence I was doing, I learned a fair amount from reading through hundreds and hundreds of contracts and looking for problems, which now luminance can do. But what I really learned was drafting the documents, being told it wasn't quite right, going back, being beaten up by the other side, you know, in the heat of battle. That's what I really learned. And I think my own view is that we worry, understandably, but a little bit too much about that, because a lot of what is done, I think it's got worse as well, because when I was a kid, we didn't spend 3 months on end in a windowless room going through warehouses full of documents, whereas actually in the 90s and noughties, that's pretty much what our teams were doing. It got worse, you know, due diligence became worse, discovery became worse, you know, a lot of that commodity actually grew and exploded in a way that I was lucky enough, I did not have so much. I used to, most of my time spent in the library researching stuff. That I worry more about because, you know, we now are based much more on commoditized research tools because we haven't got time, or rather the client is not prepared to pay for us, fair enough, to send people into a library to find an answer. And what we actually have to do is specialize much faster so that people spend more of their career doing the same thing expertly over and over and over again, as opposed to being all the lawyers. But it's a totally fair question, often asked. I worry less about it because I think if people, I mean, we're employing as law firms, very, very intelligent, highly skilled people who've spent a lot of time learning the sharper end of the law. And I think it's completely realistic to plug them in at a higher level at the start.
Right. So that means the demise of what we now call the training contract and starting at a much higher level.
I don't think, well, maybe. But I think, why not have a training contract, you know, full of work that is more intellectually challenging?
Absolutely.
You know, then so I'd say, you know, training's good, but I'd say the training I really learned was about 2 years in, you know, after I'd come away from the photocopier. And maybe if we could start the training contract there, because those first 2 years are less necessary.
A lot of the work that's going on in Belfast and is actually quite sophisticated work,
yeah.
In the two junior research or senior research,
yeah.
With the dog. So
yeah.
There's a big gap.
Yeah.
Doesn't it mean that perhaps you will recruit far fewer trainees going forward because the shape of the firm is going to be very different?
We definitely will. That's the bad news. The good news is that many, many other types of job will be created, of course, which I know you're going towards. And, you know, we've seen the diamond model. You know, it used to be a pyramid, partners, associates, trainees, etc. And then it went to the diamond model everyone was talking about, and partners and lawyers get that far, and then you get fewer junior lawyers at the bottom, and it's plugged at the sides with paralegals and machines. I've heard the rocket model as well these days, where it's all lawyers down the middle, but it's the same idea that there will be fewer lawyers at the bottom, fewer junior lawyers at the bottom doing that kind of work. That's definite. What's great though is that that will be replaced by legal tech experts, for example, people teaching the machines to do the stuff, right? With both, you know, legal brains and scientific brains. And there'll be many, many more jobs. I mean, we now hire all sorts of people like I'd never heard of, you know, project managers. We thought we did that. Well, guess what? We're not actually very good at it. We're extremely expensive at it. And the types of projects that we get to work on, in so many, I've just done one, it was in 70 countries, 6 billion was all over the place, but actually there's a lot of repetitive stuff. Each country was the same, right? So to put a project manager on that was much better than having lawyers manage it. It's far more effective for the client, cost-wise, and going back to that early point, much better for our margin too. Because instead of using lawyers to project manage and having to run it at a loss because we couldn't possibly charge our revenue salaries of those lawyers to manage that project, we use project managers at a much lower hourly rate and made a good margin on it, and the client was happy too. We always say to clients now, we want to charge you a lot less whilst making more margin ourselves. And because they're a business, going back to that one, because we're a business, they're totally fine with that. Okay? And that's the important point. We're in that changing model together. So yeah, answer is definitely fewer jobs like I used to do, fewer jobs even like the people are doing now, but there will be different jobs and there will be as many.
No,
people
can't.
You talk about profit, you really need profits to partner. You mean the business with the VPTR, real because in other words, is the partnership model going to be sustained? Or do you see the last few months, the beginnings of a trend towards corporate firms?
I mean profit. And we, for example, people may not know this, Dentons is now the biggest law firm in the world. It's twice as big as the next firm, smaller than us. Why does that matter? The reason why we did that, apart from the fact that we found ourselves in a crisis 8 years ago, I think we could have probably managed to fall over by ourselves without the Lehman crisis, but that crisis was something we didn't waste. We took a lot of risk. We did 41 mergers in 5 years and we went to the number one slot. Why does that matter? It matters for three reasons. One is because it gives us power to invest. And so, for example, now we own an accelerator in Silicon Valley where we're developing legal tech solutions. A long way to go, some are on the market. We could never have afforded to do that when we were just a partnership with, say, 70 partners, and now we're 3,500 partners. So it doesn't cost much for any of us to share that cost, to make that kind of investment. Also, a context of scale. We've got larger, as lots of firms have, because now the suppliers run after us to get our business, and they slash their costs, and we can pass that cost benefit on to the client, and then we have that talent magnet because people get excited by the journey. So size is important, but going back to your profit question, yes, I mean profit for profit's sake, so we can actually invest in a different service delivery model, which is what we're trying to do.
I'm going to cut in there. This is a great debate, and this is exactly the kind of questions I wanted to get into. I think we're actually touching on quite a few of the questions on your slide, so I'll just open it up to the wider group. Are there any other questions people would like to ask? And we've got a roving mic here that can go out to those who want to ask questions. Anybody who's been had a
Richard,
burning issue? Yeah, thank you.
Do you have any problem with the big four accountancy firms that are moving towards that? I mean, in terms of a global offer, they are going to offer services, legal services, probably the way that you want to provide the services.
But it's funny.
Is that a problem or not?
No, it's not a problem, and I think ultimately, I expect one day there'll be, Clifford Deloitte or something similar. It wouldn't surprise me at all. Clifford Lloyd McKinsey, maybe. I mean, it's multidisciplinary.
Without Dentons, yes?
Yeah, well, I'm delighted. I wouldn't mind Deloitte Dentons at all. I'd love, because although we're large, they're miles larger than us as businesses, and that would be a very nice thing actually to leverage off in terms of that investment. Again, because if you look at legal tech, yes, it's going towards a more technologically driven model, which, as I said before, I think is very good because it allows us to charge more at the right end and give more value at the right end. But we can't, as law firms, we can't afford to create the kind of AI technology that is really going to be the solution when it comes to market properly in 3 years' time. I'm not even sure that the big four can. I think it's going to be Microsoft. We now just take 6% seed positions and catch the trends and go. So I think, am I worried about it? No. To be frank, I wouldn't mind it at all. And I actually speak as someone who came from originally one of the firms, one of the legacy firms of Dentons was a firm called Wildsat. And we were going to be the legal arm at one stage of Arthur Anderson, which is obviously the best thing we ever did. But I lived through that attempted merger then, and it was remarkable actually how different the two business models are. They're both professional services firms or businesses, but they're based, without going into too much of the weeds here, on completely different models. And therefore, it couldn't work then. I think it'll take a while before it can work between law firms and accounting firms. But as law firms get bigger and close the gap, I think then the models get closer and it might work more. But I would welcome it.
Thanks. Any other questions? There's a question up there. Thank you. I don't think we can get the mic to the questions. You shout us now, of course. Thank you.
So I'm building a crowdsourced legal opinion service, basically, to be honest. maternity leave and changing how part-time work, which impacts on the sector. We're also seeing the first stage, perhaps, of general counsel, people needing housing provide.
General counsel, what's
it? Much more people working in house, providers are actually conducting rather than actually going to law firms. So within that, and also we talked a lot about high-end commercial work here, but really rather than just the standardised contracts and that kind of stuff, but there is actually sort of people who don't have the same kind of funds and what many lawyers may go to work for smaller entities. So really where I'm coming to is the question of, will the greatest disruptor for the legal sector be a litigant in person with an internet connection?
No, it will. Maybe for a part of the legal market. Just going back to a couple of things you said around what businesses look like. It's funny to start dichotomy between business and law firms. Law firms are business, I'll say it again. We have, you mentioned flexitimes from the business, believe me, diversity, flexitime, inclusion, all that stuff is rife, rampant, and very healthily, vitally alive, in law firms, and all far better for it. So our workforce works in a very similar way to, in fact, I would dare to say, in most cases, in a more agile and flexible way than most of the corporates that we work for. I would say we're probably ahead, actually, on that front. Coming back to your business model, though, which I think is fascinating, interesting, and definitely there will be a place in the market for that. I don't think, though, it's going to replace what big law firms are doing now. It will, I think, flexible working models can operate at all parts of the market. Let's put it
that. And I think that we're talking about the work that big business wants from external law firms. The much bigger bit, by a huge amount, is the day-to-day needs of someone in their life. Richard and I are both part of Law Without Walls, and what Law Without Walls tries to do is help some of that social injustice around legal systems. So many parts of the world, including places you wouldn't expect to see it, like America, people with really legitimate legal needs are not being met. And anything that people like yourself and others can do within that space, it's a huge area of need, and it's almost like a bottomless pit. So if you are able to help people and get the right legal advice or to defend themselves when they come up with these cases, I think that's a very, very good idea.
And I just finish by saying that, law firms of the type that we are unashamedly focused on profit. We're not focused on helping society, let's say it. We have questioned ourselves on that. I don't presume to speak for the profession, but I think knowing enough people in the profession who are involved in pro bono effort, there's a different model. Our model can't really work to help the small guy. And it's not really our mission. But we have, and certainly I know on our global board, we've looked very closely. In fact, our mission statement, one of our principles is to be in and of the community. So we did 39,000 hours of programming last year. I'm not saying that to say, oh, it'll be great. I'm just saying we've decided we make money over here out of big corporates. It doesn't mean we don't feel we have a responsibility as well, but we do that for free. We have legal clinics for free, and we have a legal pop-up clinic, and we do lots of other things. But it's very hard to make our model work on a money-making basis or a charging basis at that end of the scale. We don't ignore it, but to make money work.
What about the students in the audience? I'd like to know if you're feeling more optimistic after we spoke, or whether you're feeling, what's the temperature in the room from our students? And if you're not going to ask questions, I'm going to ask you to put your hands up, okay? From all the students here, who here is feeling more optimistic about the future? Okay? And who here is feeling less optimistic about the future?
Okay. Pretty even split between those who are willing to do that.
Can I just make an observation, not the student, and it's coming up for 25 years. articles of association at a city firm. And over time, obviously, the nature of the work that we do has evolved. But I think the positive is that I've seen successive roles that I've done, starting from a paralegal, paginating things in Herbert Smith's, you know, for a discovery process, through to training work, through to PSL work, where things have become commoditized and done differently. But every time that's happened, the marketplace has demanded new services from the firms that I've worked for, and new roles have evolved. And I'm now doing the role in the city firm, connected with client training, client support, that simply didn't exist 20 years ago, or even 15 years ago. So that's the positive. Old work goes, but new forms of work are demanded.
I think on that positive note, I might draw things to a close. I'm sure you've got more questions, but Moray and Richard are going to come along to our drinks event now afterwards, so please do feel free to grab them for a continuation of these conversations. So I want to end by thanking all of you for coming out this evening. I hope you enjoyed this evening's talk, and I hope you'll join us for a drink now. I'd like to thank Madeline Ryan, our events officer, and our student ambassadors who helped and created this event tonight, and we're delighted and very grateful for them. And I'd also like to thank our speakers, Richard and Moray, for their excellent talk, which I think has been extremely thought-provoking and really given us a lot to chew over as we go forward. So thank you again to Richard and to Moray, and thank you to you.